Well, good morning and welcome to New Hope Community Church. It's great to have you with us today. I hear something. It's probably me. I did it. But anyway, thanks for being here today. We had about 20 of the regular 9:15 folks came to the 8 o'clock service. The kind of this one whole pew that normally sits right here, they were all over there. And then Fawn, where are you? Come here, Fawn. Okay, Fawn has to show off her T-shirt. Her small group showed up at 8 o'clock wearing this T-shirt. All right? Now, she has a little bling on her end. The men did not have the bling on theirs. But tell them why your small group has these T-shirts.
Well, for those of you that were here last week, remember part of Tim's sermon, he gave us a challenge. He had the diagram up on the screen, the circle, the in and the slash and the out. And he challenged us, you make a choice. Are you in or are you out? Or if you don't make any choice, you're automatically out. So right afterwards, our small group got together and we decided to accept that challenge and we're in. We're in for wherever Jesus wants to lead us, basically. We're going to be open, but we're going to actively pursue our relationship with Him and spreading it to the world rather than just kind of going with the flow and sitting and being. We're in. We're all out.
Amen. Amen. All right. I love it. I love it. It's one of the values of small group, all right? You get to take what you hear sometimes on Sunday and make it real, and I love that in their group. And if you're new to New Hope and you haven't heard us make a big push for small groups, you would like to know more about it, get one of the cards in the pew in front of you, write on it, hey, I want some small group information, and our small group leaders will follow up with you on that. But the purpose of small groups are basically to accomplish four things, and that is so we can connect relationally with others. You don't get a chance to make good friendships sitting here on the pew in church staring at the back of somebody's head, and that's what small groups is all about. You get to get better acquainted. I can point to this small group right here, and I can tell you some of them have made trips to Mexico and other Pismo and where else, and they had never met before. Small group. Yeah, and see, you connect and you do things together. So it's also to grow spiritually. It's not just about fun and games. You're engaged in Bible study on a weekly basis. You reach out to others. That's part of what this is. Some of our small groups have gone into assisted living facilities, and they have ministered to folks there on a monthly and or weekly basis. Another small group called Girls for God that meets twice a year for about 6 to 10 weeks at a time. They just are wrapping up spending the last 6 weeks at Orchard Park. And these are young teenage girls from junior high through high school who are pairing up with women and men who are living in assisted living, and they have read to them. They have taken a diary, and they've asked them questions about growing up and what life was like when they were young, and they played bingo with them. And so they've just had a great experience. So that's part of what small groups is all about, is reaching out to others, something you would probably never do all by yourself. And then last of all is serving others, reaching out in service projects to be of help. So if you'd like to know more about small groups, pull out a card, and they'll be happy to get that information to you. If you are a guest here at New Hope today, it's your first time, thanks for coming. There are some guest cards in the pew in front of you. I'd love for you to fill it out. Drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. We promise we're not gonna beat on your door and pester you. We would like to get some information in your hands that answer a lot of questions that you might have. So if you drop that in the bag, we'd say thanks. We got something new working today. Were they out in the last service? Did you see guys with bright yellow vests on out in the parking lot? All right, that's not a big deal for you when you arrive. This is brand new today. It may be a big deal for you as you leave. Okay, here's the thing. Between the 9:15 and the 10:45 service, we don't have a lot of turnaround time, and that's when the parking lot is the busiest. And normally this service is full, and so the parking lot is often full. And so people are circling around. We have people parking out in the field and on the sides, and it's just not a great flow. So between the 9:15 and 10:45 service, you will notice our parking posse out in the parking lot in their bright yellow vests. Please do not run over them, okay? Please, all right? Number two, please don't say, this is the way I always leave the parking lot, okay? They are going to be directing traffic between the 9:15 and 10:45. There will be some cones set up to prohibit you from going out a particular direction. You all will be going out the far parking exit, all right? Not the closest one, the far one. People coming in will be coming in that one. We hope to cut down on some of the traffic jams that we have in our parking lot between services. So it'll take a week or two for us to unlearn the way we've always done it before and to learn a new way, and they're new with this. These are not experienced law enforcement personnel, all right? They have not directed traffic, all right, ever before. And so it's just kind of a new thing to help. And probably today it's not that big a deal because it's a holiday weekend and folks are out traveling and doing things. The reason this whole pew is not here in this service, but we're over there in the early service, is because there's a junk show in downtown Clovis today, and they wanted to get there early. Actually, I believe it's an antique event going on down there. That's just what one of the guys called it at 8 o'clock, all right? But anyway, so it probably won't be as bad today, but it will help us on most of our under Sunday, so this is a good day for us to get our first run out there, all right? Let me highlight a couple of special events that are coming up. Actually, there are some sign-up sheets going around. Same as last week, so nothing new. If you weren't here last week, the white sheet on top is for our pasta feed next Sunday evening at 5:30. This helps our 4th, 5th, and 6th graders go to camp. And if you would like to bring a pasta dish, salad, or bread to make that possible, they would love to know that. Many of you volunteered last week. You don't need to sign up again. The pink sheet on the bottom is for you ladies. They are having a Reveal Your Secret Pal coming up on June the 6th. If you're a secret pal, you know all about that. If you are a lady and you don't know about it, you can sign up and come. You might want to be a part of it next time. But they need you to sign up so they have enough food because Fawn does not want to be blamed that they run out. Okay? So that would be important for you then. Let's see here. What else? Oh, next Saturday night, the sanctuary is going to be transformed into a theater. All right, and this is going to be movie night here at New Hope, and there's been a change in movies because just since we met last Sunday, the movie Do You Believe, which was just in the theaters less than 3 months ago, has now been released for private showings. So we were able to secure it. So if you did not see the movie Do You Believe, show up Saturday night and you can see it, all right? And the admission is cheap. It's free. If you want to make a donation, donate underwear. Okay, small group, remember, they're looking for packages of new, unused underwear, all right? Still in their package, any size, guys or gals, children, adults, for a special project one of our small groups is doing. This movie night is being sponsored by our small group coordinators, and so come out and join us, get acquainted with other folks this coming Saturday evening. That's at 6 o'clock. The following night here at the church, out in the pavilion and the bridge, will be the pasta feed that you are volunteering to bring the food to. If you would go out these doors when you leave today, you could buy a ticket to buy the food that you made and help raise money for the 4th, 5th, and 6th graders as they go to camp this summer, all right? So that will be terrific. I think I took care of that. Oh, a couple of special projects went on this week. The Haneys used their home to host us a special event to let folks know about Care Fresno. This is an organization that's been involved in the Fresno-Clovis area for really over 20 years now. And if you would like to know more about it, there's some contact information, but I just wanted to give a shout out to the Haneys for opening their doors and making about a dozen folks in our congregation aware of a ministry that's here in the area. And then Kathy Lewis. Kathy's involved in the Youth for Christ, particularly in a ministry that Youth for Christ has in addressing the needs of young high school girls who are pregnant. And they come alongside of them. They take them through a Bible study. They take them through some basic training for motherhood that they've never experienced before. And in this last group, about 15 of them gave their lives to Christ. And at an event, yeah, that's worth applauding over. Absolutely. And so they arranged a baptism to baptize all 15 of these young ladies, and New Covenant hosted it at their church one evening this past week. Kathy had already purchased a Bible and had her girl that she mentored, her name put on it, gave it to her at the Bible class the week before the baptism, and all the other girls looked on green with envy. And so Kathy proposed to us here at the church, is it possible if we could buy 14 other Bibles and get names engraved and make a gift to all of those? And so your church family, all right, by the gifts that you give and the offering we're about to take in a few minutes, because of your generosity, we were able also to be generous, and we bought 14 Bibles with names engraved, and those were presented to them after their baptism this past Thursday night. So a shout out to Kathy Lewis and what she was able to help us be a small part of. Celebrate recovery. We don't say a lot about it all the time, and we mention it as often as we can. It meets every Thursday night. It's been going on for over 6 years now. Do we have our seventh anniversary?
We have our sixth.
Six, and we're going to have our seventh next year. All right. So we're excited about what goes on in Celebrate Recovery. It's not just for folks who have alcohol or substance abuse issues. It's defined around here as hurts, habits, or hang-ups. Most of you have experienced hurt. Some of you have been the cause of hurts. CR's for you. Some of you have habits, okay, that aren't healthy for you. All different kinds of habits. And it often changes you. There's one habit that many of us have in this room that probably could be addressed. It changes our shape on a regular basis. Okay? We don't ever put that one in the same category, but it's a habit, and sometimes it's destructive. And hang-ups. There are... somebody's canceling breakfast now, all right, after church. There are hang-ups. There are some things that have happened to you in the past that still have you hung up and hung out to dry. There are some anger issues that probably some of you have. There are some prejudices that you keep under wraps. Celebrate Recovery is for you. So I just want you to remember, it meets on Thursday nights, all right? But also along with that, if you got your life all together and you don't have any hurts, you don't have any habits, you don't have any hang-ups, you are a perfect candidate to be available to help in ministry. Because, man, if you are perfect, by all means, we ought to have plenty of volunteers, all right? And I'm going to attempt, this is a decision I made this last week, I'm going to attempt to eliminate a word out of my vocabulary in the future. And that word I'm going to eliminate is the word volunteer. I am not going to ever personally ask any of you to volunteer for anything at New Hope again. I'm not. I am going to ask if there are men and women in this church who are available to let God work through them. Okay? You see, there's a difference. There's a difference. There's a difference between those two words. A volunteer, we think we're doing something good out of our generous heart for somebody else in an area of expertise that we think we're good at. That's where we normally volunteer. You don't volunteer to prepare food if you're not a pretty good cook. If you do, you usually don't get asked again. But that's another story. You don't usually teach a Sunday school class unless you think you're good at teaching. Okay? You don't normally volunteer for various things unless you have some good. But that's not true in God's economy. What I'm looking for folks who want to be engaged are folks who have a heart to be used by God, and you'll put yourself available to do that. So the task is not important. The availability is what's important. God will lead you, and He's going to lead you out of your comfort zone. Trust me, He will move you. You may start in a comfort zone, but if you're available, He'll move you beyond the comfort zone. So with that, Celebrate Recovery is looking for some men and women who would be available in certain areas. I know one of those areas is in some food. I know some of those areas is childcare on Thursday nights. Do I have some other things besides those two? Okay, so a sound tech, okay, on Thursday night, all right? So, see Eric, if you are a person who is available for God to use in any of those areas. I forgot to mention this. That's why I put it in here. Gene, would you stand up? Deacon Dave is not here, but we'll get half of you up. Gene, would you stand up, please? Gene Sperling and Deacon Dave, last week in the 8 o'clock service, showed up wearing the exact same shirt, okay? And a picture was taken of them, and it got sent to my wife, okay, who was not feeling well. She was home in bed, and she got the picture, and since she could not be engaged in worship, she still thought she would be engaged. So she took that picture of the two of you dressed in identical shirts, one tucked in, the other one left out. Deacon David, and she put it on the church Facebook and asked for votes of which one looked better. So that ran for about 48 hours, and you had hundreds of responses, and it ended up in a tie. So each of them received a Starbucks card this morning in the 8 o'clock service for their suave and debonair look. So you just never know what may happen around New Hope Church. But anyway, that was great fun. A couple things I want you to pray for and thank God for. First of all, Polly Good from our 8 o'clock service, been through a lot of treatment, all right? She's been through a lot of treatment. She went up north for surgery, for cancer surgery. She's been home now for 8 weeks, almost 9 weeks recovering. The last several weeks before surgery, she was here with a bonnet on, and then she got rid of the bonnet and just went bald and looked great. Her attitude, this is what I love, she was at perfect peace well before the surgery. She said, if I live, it's great. If I die, I'm going to heaven. That's good too. And she had this perfect peace. Today she was back. It's in remission. She will not need any more chemotherapy at the moment. She said, you never know what's down the road. So that's a real praise item for Polly Good. I want you to continue to remember to pray for Teresa. All right, we shared last week that Teresa is in a new season of life, and she will be away from us for about a year. She is dealing with some of those things that have been hurts and kind of nagging habits and wants ultimate victory over them. And so she's going to be locally for a while, and she'll be out of state for a while. We do not want the idea of absence makes the memory get shorter. We want to continue to lift Teresa up in our prayers and our thoughts. And as soon as we're given the okay, we'll let you know when you can begin to write so you can send cards of encouragement to her while she's away. And then please be in prayer for us as a staff as we go through our search for a youth pastor. We've already had one interview last weekend. We have another one set up for next weekend. And in the next couple of days, we'll establish two other interviews that we have. So please be in prayer. That's a very, very important decision that we need to make around here. So those are just a few of the things that I wanted to bring to your Patty. Yes. Okay, Larry Gallet used to be a member here and part of our church at the time that we merged. Had just been told his heart is not functioning properly, only at about 5%. He's at St. Agnes Hospital. So if you'd remember Larry Gallet, appreciate it very, very much. And Patty is out of the hospital. She's home. Please continue to remember to pray for Patty. So just a few updates around here. I'm going to ask you to stand as our ushers come and wait on us and we have our morning tithes and offerings. Then we'll engage in our worship. Our Father, thanks for the life that you have with us. Every morning that we wake up, the adventure of life that you have planned is available to us. We don't always follow that plan. Quite frankly, some days we don't even submit to it at all. Life becomes very routine and mundane, and sometimes we like it. We like the same regularity of a daily schedule. And so we give no room for divine interruptions. We give no room for divine appointments. We give so little room for divine activity. And so, Father, I pray today in the quietness of this moment, all of us will give some thought to how we want to begin this week. We've started it right by being in a place of worship, being engaged in the acts of worship. But, Father, where the rubber meets the road is going to be tomorrow morning, how we start our Monday, of whether we're going to be enslaved to the routine of our schedules, or, Father, whether we're going to be liberated by the freedom of your activity in us. And sometimes, Father, you can't tell the difference between the two because sometimes a regular routine is what you have for us. You just want to know if we are available for those moments when you want to interject your will and your wisdom that supersede our routines. I pray you'll find a host of men and women out of this service who will say yes to that kind of freedom tomorrow. Father, thank you for the great news of Polly Good and her service, her being in service with us today. Thank you for Patty that she's out of the hospital. Continue to trust you with her recovery. Lord, for Larry Gallett at St. Agnes, may he experience your peace that passes understanding, knowing that to live is Christ, to die, it's better. That's the kind of peace that you offer to us. It's a peace that's beyond human comprehension or understanding. Father, thank you for what it is that you have to share with us today, how you want to challenge us, how you may want to take us one more step in this process of transformation. We say thank you for the privilege of giving and sharing. We do so out of delight in our heart because of your generosity to us. We commit all this to you in the name of Christ. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Though they may have been tired, lonely, homesick, or scared, they literally put their lives on hold, giving unsparingly of themselves, sacrificing. They are our grandfathers, grandmothers, our aunts, our uncles, our fathers and brothers, our sisters and friends. They have risked their lives to allow us to have the freedoms we enjoy today. Freedom to speak as we like. Freedom to pursue dreams. Freedom to lie down safe in our beds at night. Freedom to worship. As we gather to worship our Creator in freedom today, we recognize this as a great honor. Veterans, we're humbled by your sacrifice. We admire and applaud your courage. And as we freely worship our Creator together, we simply want to say thank you for all the sacrifices you've made.
I don't know how many of you are aware, but today is a special day literally around the world. This has been declared the Global Day of Prayer. You know, here in the United States, a few weeks ago, we had the Day of Prayer. But today, it's called the Global Day of Prayer, and there are churches all over the world. There are small groups all over the world. There are clusters of believers from all different backgrounds grouping together to pray for our world. Not just to pray for the United States, not just to pray for our own lives, but literally to pray for two things. One, the Christians who are in places in this world that are under heavy persecution. Places like Burma, where just recently several lost their lives because they would not recant their faith in Jesus Christ. And so it is about praying for the church that is being persecuted. And number two, it is praying for the church universally, wherever it is, that it be the church God intended us to be, that we be a church that makes a difference in the world. And so in the city of Clovis, there's going to be a group of believers getting together this afternoon. City of Fresno, I think they're meeting at People's Church. In Clovis, our site is at Mountain View Community Church. That is on Fowler, just south of Ashland Avenue. It's the one that's kind of got a tent roof on it, all right? So down Fowler, just past Ashland Avenue on the east side of the road. And at 4:30 is going to be what they call worship unplugged, all right? So it'll probably be music just like shake, shake, shake for about 30 minutes, all right? And then at 5 o'clock, the actual hour and 15 minutes of prayer and worship will be engaged. And so believers from churches all over Clovis and Fresno will be meeting today to do that. If you would like to go and you need something in your hand to remind you of it, I'm going to have about half of these just sitting right up here, okay? and you can pick one of those up. There is not an address on there, all right? So that's why I gave you directions. It tells you the name of the church, but I don't believe the address is anywhere on it. So Mountain View Community Church, Fred and David, the pastors there, a couple of great guys, and they've had a team from others in the city of Clovis that have put this together. And so if you'd like to join them this afternoon, that would be absolutely terrific. When the fasten your seatbelt sign comes on when you're on an airplane, it means one of three things. You're about to take off, you're about to land, or the plane is experiencing turbulence while it's in the air. All three of these are critical times during a flight. Why are they critical times? Because all three of these times are transition moments. In the case of taking off, we know what to expect. We're going to ground zero and we are going to climb rapidly into the beautiful blue sky. Landing, we know what to expect. We are going to leave the beautiful blue skies and we are going to have a soft, safe landing back to Mother Earth. But in mid-flight, when the fasten the seatbelt sign comes on, we just don't know what we're in store for. People that I know who don't like to fly, every one of them has a turbulent story for the reason they don't want to fly. But in mid-flight, that causes us the greatest concern. When the captain in mid-flight turns off that sign and says, "You are free to move about the cabin," there is a sigh of relief to everybody on board. Ever since 9/11, for us as a nation here in the United States, the captain has turned on the fasten the seatbelt sign. There's trouble ahead. It's a nice sound. The day after 9/11, when that seatbelt sign went on, we didn't know if we were in for a short, small bump. We had no idea that it was going to turn into a long, exaggerated, big bump in history. We're still not sure. We still don't have that same sense of safety and security we had before 9/11. We're unsure about our future in a lot of areas. Will our economy surge ahead like it once did? Will terrorism become a thing of the past? Are we in for several more years of uncertainty as we have already had? It could be that the fasten seatbelt sign has come on for you personally. Maybe just in recent days, your daughter sat down with you and said, "Mom, Dad, I'm pregnant." Maybe you went to the doctor for a checkup and he called you in recent days and said, "Call me back ASAP. Maybe you've heard the rumor that your company is closing down and your job is at risk. Maybe your marriage is in turmoil. Whatever the case, whatever the source of the turbulence, as the situation is in a jet, you and I are out of control. When you're sitting in a plane and that sign goes on, how much control do you have over what happens next? Absolutely none. And that's where most of us are in the turbulence we have in life. Actually, what you and I have to come to the conclusion is we've never been in control. We thought we were, but now in these realities, we've discovered we really aren't. But it's sure fun to think we are, isn't it? And when the reality of the situation is staring us in the face personally and nationally, it becomes very, very frightening. Here's the good news I have to share with you. That most of this book, most of these scriptures that are found in this book were written in the environment of uncertainty. Ever since Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, everything else was written in uncertainty. Even you say, "No, Tim, how about the book of Revelation? Look at the seven churches it was written to." It was written in a time of great uncertainty. So God is very familiar with the predicaments of our life. This book is not filled with feel-good messages for a world that we don't live in. Here in this book, we find God speaking directly to you and to me in uncertain times. Maybe more comforting, we see God's hand at work in the midst of uncertainty. There's a character in the Old Testament, Joseph. Many of you probably know a lot about him. Some of you may have no idea who I'm talking about, but Joseph found himself as a young teenager in a literal pit in the ground. And while he was in that pit several feet below, he listened to his brothers on the rim of that pit debate whether they were going to sell him or kill him. You want to talk about a dysfunctional family? Joseph had one. And he had to sit there in the pit and listen, am I going to die here or am I going to be sold? And heaven knows what will happen next. And what we discover in that story of Joseph is that God was right there in the pit with him. King David was awakened one morning to the rumor that his very own flesh and blood, his own son, was conspiring against him to take his throne away. David had no literal proof that he could go and address it, and many of the Psalms that are written in the biggest book of the Bible were written by David in this period of uncertainty in his life. And what you will find as you read those Psalms is the God who had been with David as a boy, taking care of his father's sheep when he fought a lion and a bear, when he was a boy taking cheese and crackers to his brothers at the front line of battle, to the boy who confronted the giant Goliath, the God who was with him and delivered him from the hand of the bear and the lion and the giant. He discovered that same God was with him as king in a potential overthrow. And then there's the Apostle Paul, the writer of over half of the New Testament. Apostle Paul thought God had called him to ministry, to preaching the gospel, to establishing the first century church. But he found himself bound and dragged into prison. His future seemed to be a blur from what he thought. It is from prison that Paul writes the book of Philippians, along with many of the other books in the New Testament. And he writes to us about what to do when God's promises don't seem to be coming true. Have you ever had a moment in your life? Are you in a moment in your life right now where it seems like that God's promises aren't coming true? Do you feel like Joseph and you're in a pit? And everybody is talking about you while you were in the pit? Do you feel like King David and you've been awakened out of a good sleep with an uneasy feeling that you're about to be betrayed? One afternoon, an angel appeared to a young teenage girl and announced that she was going to give birth to a child. The Bible says when Mary got the news that she was pregnant, she was perplexed. Any of you felt perplexed? You'll understand Mary. What did this mean for Mary? It meant the future was completely different than she anticipated. Now here's the deal. Joseph in a pit. David awakened out of a good night's rest. Paul in prison. Mary pregnant. All of those had different futures than any of them thought they were going to have. And yet God was present with them in every single one of those situations. And the outcome was not just about the person in the predicament. King David had many more Psalms to write. Paul had more books of the Bible to pen, and being in prison gave him time to write. God's calling. Mary, she blessed the world. God has a plan for Joseph. Joseph, We're going to get it figured out. Maybe this would be a good time to say, if any of you have cell phones, turn them to the silent mode. Joseph went from the pit. They chose not to kill him. They sold him to a group of marauding traders in the desert who sold him to a guy named Potiphar in the big city, who he served Potiphar well, but as Potiphar's wife, and what a horrible name. I've always said, maybe the worst name I've ever heard in my life, Potiphar. You could almost see why his wife wanted to cheat on him, all right? Almost. And Potiphar should have married Gomer, all right? They would have been a wonderful couple out of the Bible. But then Potiphar's wife lies about Joseph and he goes into prison. And we're saying, wow, could anything worse happen to us? No, this was all good stuff. Because until Joseph ended up in prison, he wouldn't be in the place to where he could interpret a dream of the Pharaoh so that Pharaoh would pull him out of prison, make him second in command for all the land of Egypt to save them, all right, from a drought, from 7 years of famine. But it wasn't to save Egypt. It was to save Joseph's family who had thrown him in the pit in the first place. Is that not amazing? But why did that family need to be saved? Because those were the fathers of the nations of Israel. We see our own little pit and think, poor me. When sometimes in the pit that we find ourselves in, God has a far more grand scheme and purpose to accomplish if we will trust Him. This book is filled with stories of people facing uncertainty and discovering that not only is God not absent from them, but He is often diligently at work accomplishing His will in this world and in the lives of those that He loves. This is a book about how very much God is in control and how very much we are not in control. And that is exactly why we will not like some of the answers that we find here when it comes to responding to uncertainty and turbulent times. I suggest we want the answer to be something like this. Give me three things I can do so my life will go back to normal. That's the kind of answers that we want when we pray. God, give me three steps to do, life will go back to normal, and I will be in control again. What we find in Scripture often seems much too passive. It leaves us too vulnerable and too dependent. A lot of us, when the fasten the seatbelt sign comes on in the airplane, we don't want to fasten the seatbelt. I want the turbulence to go away. Isn't that often how you pray? God, you keep your seatbelt and make the turbulence go away. I want my spouse to change, things to get back to normal. That was your normal. Might not have been theirs or God's normal. I want my kids to behave. I want my boss to treat me better. I want my hurts, habits, and hang-ups to become my health, my wealth, and my prosperity, and I don't want to have to do anything. I don't want to be guided through. I want to be led around the turbulence. I want to find something in here that will guarantee my safety. I want to find something in here that will guarantee terrorism will end. I want to find in here a cure for all the diseases of mankind. I want to find in here a booming economy. I want to find in here a sustained rally on Wall Street. Where are those verses? As frustrating as some of the answers might be that we find in the Bible, the options are worse. What are the options? Worry? Panic? Overreaction? Fear?
I've experienced all four of those at one time or another in my life, and sometimes all four at once, and that just isn't very healthy. And you know what I've discovered? Not a one of those or a combination of those are very productive. Did you know that things I've worried about, worry didn't improve the situation, not one time? I've tried it multiple times to see if it would work. Not once did worry work. Panic. How'd that work out for you? Never turned out good. Oh, the next one, though, is mine. It's the butt buster. Overreaction. Tell me one time when you overreacted to situations that it turned out for your good. Tell me one time when you overreacted, you didn't say minutes later, I wished I hadn't done that. Regret has followed every one of my overreactions. And then fear. I look back at things that we didn't do because of fear, and I see blessings that were missed. Joy that I bypassed. And I look back at moments when by God's grace or by peer pressure, I overcame the fear. And I look at the moments of blessing and joy that were mine because I tried something, I did something that I was scared to do before. Walking the High Line Trail in Montana. Thousands of feet straight down on a path about that wide. Whew. Incredible, though. Incredible. Generally, these kind of reactions, worry, panic, overreaction, and fear, they generally make things worse for us. Relationally, we're never going to get anybody's undivided attention. And if that's what we're focusing on, we end up very self-centered. It's about me. Financially, we make decisions based on our ability to predict the future. And when we can't get it quite like we want it, what do? We shop to kill the pain. And men, don't look at your wives right now. They shop for shoes, you shop for cars. Big difference in the price tag. Okay? Big difference in the price tag. Don't underestimate what God says about the times of uncertainty. Uncertain times are not new to Him. This is not an instruction manual on how to get control back in your life. It's how to get life. It's back to normal, which is God's normal. God's in charge. It's about learning to follow through the valleys with confidence that God is in control and that His purposes personally and nationally will not be thwarted. So what do? Over the next 4 weeks, we're going to talk about four things to do. And the first one is probably the most predictable. Any idea what it might be? Since this is the global day of... The first thing to do in times of uncertainty is to pray. Turn to Philippians chapter 4, verse 4, and we'll see what Paul has to say to us from a prison cell. Do you think those were uncertain times? What Paul writes with a bruised, beaten, and bloodied back, think those were uncertain times? Paul from prison instructs us to pray in times of uncertainty. After he's been shipwrecked in Malta, Paul arrives in Rome during the reign of Nero. Most of you have smartphones and iPads and things. When you go home, why don't you just Google Nero? See what kind of guy he was. Okay? You're in for the shock of your life. This was not a good time to be a Christian in Rome. Paul is writing to a church that is 700 miles away, 4 months of travel in order for Paul to get from Rome to Philippi. So he writes this letter, and in chapter 4, verse 4, and by the way, the book of Philippians, as many of you already know, is known as the book of joy in the entire Bible. And the book of joy was written while a man is in a prison cell with a bruised, beaten, and bloody back. Uncertain times? Absolutely. Here's what he says, chapter 4, verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. And I will say it again. Rejoice. Paul says, in case you thought I stuttered, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. It occurred to me as I read this time, I never thought, gentleness and joy are both fruit of the Spirit. And we're probably more gentle when we're joyful than when we're not. What's the opposite of joy? Sorrow. We tend to be less gentle when we are sorrowful. We tend to be hurt. We tend to be uneasy. We tend to be agitated. We tend to be frustrated. And so the natural fruit of the Spirit gets overridden by the natural juices of the human life. And so he says, choose to be joyful, and in this attitude of joy, your gentleness will be evident to all around you. The Lord is near. He's right here. He's in the pit with Joseph. He's in the bedroom with King David when he's awakened out of a good night's sleep. He's with Paul in a prison cell. He was with Mary when she was pregnant. He'll be with you when your future is turning out different than you had planned. He's there. He's present. Do not be anxious about anything, but in what? Everything. Nothing's left out. By prayer and petition, how? With thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and it'll guard your minds in Christ Jesus. Rejoice. Why? Because the Lord is here. In the midst of uncertainty, don't be sucked into the same sense of gloom and doom as everybody else. We should know who is in control. God hasn't gone anywhere. He has never left you. Don't let uncertainty impact your character. Be gracious and be gentle. Don't lose your influence. Don't allow bad behavior to prompt you to lose your sphere of influence. And some of you are saying, I don't have any influence. Yes, you do. You have influence in your family. You have influence in a neighborhood. You have influence where you work. Some people's sphere of influence may be bigger than others, but all of us have a sphere of influence. Don't destroy that. Don't destroy that in tough times. You and I have a choice to rejoice. Joy is a choice. It is a fruit of the Spirit you and I can choose to eat from, or we can choose to ignore it. Do not look for the thorns among the roses. Rather, be thankful that among the thorns there are beautiful roses. Listen to what the prophet Habakkuk said in the Old Testament. Probably one of the least read books of the Bible is the book of Habakkuk. It's found in chapter 3, verses 17 through 19. Let me read it for you. Habakkuk writes these words. He says, though the fig tree does not bud. There was a time the Central Valley knew a lot about fig trees. Those orchards are few and far between now. But imagine 60 years ago here, and the fig trees wouldn't blossom. And though there are no grapes on the vines, we know a lot about vineyards in this valley. Try to imagine this valley going an entire season without one grape showing up on the vines. Though the olive crop fails, and though the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen, and though there is no cattle in the stalls, does this sound like uncertain times? Most definitely. Habakkuk says, yet I will rejoice in the Lord and I will be joyful in God my Savior. Habakkuk said, in spite of the circumstances, I have a choice. And the choice I make is to experience the joy of the Lord. I will rejoice in God. The words, I will, revealed Habakkuk's belief that he could choose his response. He could either sink into despair or he could rejoice in God's presence and power. His decision to rejoice was not a denial of hardship or sorrow. It was a choice that God is sufficient for him. Notice some more of Paul's words here. Paul says, be anxious for what? for nothing. Don't be anxious about anything. This is where I need to step aside and let the scriptures speak for themselves. You can look at me at this moment and say, what does that preacher know? I am quoting a prisoner who knows what happens to Christians under Nero's reign. He is staring down the barrels of extermination along with the cause. Because if Nero had his way, there would be no evidence of a church to exist. And Paul writes from that environment, be anxious for nothing. But, before we get to the but, let's talk about anxious just a moment. Anxious, what does that mean? It means to be troubled by or distracted by the cares of our life or the fears they bring. The context is always a concern about the future. What will tomorrow bring? What are we supposed to do? Paul tells us, but rather than be anxious about what might happen, but in everything, let your requests be made known to God. I can hear some of you already objecting in your mind saying, Tim, I've already done that, but I'm still anxious and stressed out. Besides, nothing happens, nothing changes. Paul here is not talking about a little prayer that goes, Lord, you know my needs, so I'm just going to give them to you. He's not talking about emergency prayers in the car that says, Lord, keep the light green till I get through it. He's not talking about, please notice, by prayer, supplication, thanksgiving. He reiterates it again and again and again. This is a deep, serious conversation with God. Look how he describes the process. By prayer, by supplication, he's repeating it for emphasis and intensity with thanksgiving. And this is such a great word in prayer because too many times what you and I do is what we did today, which is appropriate. We thanked God for Pauli Good's improvement. And that's a worthwhile thing to do, but that's just good manners. We've been taught that since we were small kids by our parents. When somebody does something nice for you, say thank you. This is not after the fact. Paul is saying, before the outcome is known, thank God that he is sufficient. Thank God that his plans and his purposes in our turbulence is going to be worth the problems we're going through. Saying thanks in advance is a demonstration of faith and trust. The next thing he says is, present your requests to God. The old King James, and I think in the New American Standard, they both render that passage this way, let your requests be made known. Literally, that phrase means reveal the mystery of your request, something that unfolds that was not previously known. Now, understand, the idea here is not to inform God of something that he didn't previously know. God knows. So if God already knows, who's the one that's going to get it figured out in this conversation? Yeah. While I'm talking to God, while I am pouring out what all this is inside of me, okay, most of us pray kind of like the way men communicate in marriage. And that is, we only tell our wives the part that makes us look good. Guys, is that not fairly accurate? Most of the time, we keep it in here. I often talk in premarital counseling. I admire women. I admire women because you can just vomit everything in your head right out onto the table. And then you can play in it. And I think it's incredible. Us guys, that's the reason men have a much higher rate of heart attack than women do. We hold it in. We don't want to let it out. They let it out, and then you know what? They could just leave the mess there and come back later to it. They want to get it out. No. But when all of us, men and women, talk to God, we often, I used to do this. I was probably 35 before, I was pastoring 3 or 4 years before I figured this out. What I'm thinking about that I'm going to say in my prayer before I pray, God heard it. But I always thought I need to figure out what I want to say so I say it really good to God. As if I might get a different answer. I might get what I was looking for. So this idea is not to inform God here, but it's to discover what it is that you and I are really after and verbalize that to God. Learn and unearth what it is that we fear and what it is that we desire and say it out loud. The focus here is revealing what's on the inside of it. Pour it out in the presence of God. Again, in premarital counseling, one of the things that I ask prospective husbands and wives, soon to be husband and wife, to do is tell me what your expectations for marriage are. On the page there where they get to do that, there's a place for 10 or 12 responses. I rarely get more than 3 or 4. And I say, wow, you guys are going to have an easy time in marriage. You only have 3 or 4 expectations. That's, you know what, that's, man, that's a piece of cake. I said, most couples, when they get married, have dozens, if not hundreds, of expectations. And then I began to talk about expectations for sex. They didn't write that one down. And I said, oh, don't you all plan on having sex in marriage? Well, yeah. How come we didn't write it down? I said, you guys have expectations about who's going to do the dishes and who is going to fill the cars with gas, don't you? Well, yeah. Well, how come we didn't write it down? And I give a list of 4 or 5 other things, and I say, well, they say, well, I thought it would make me look trite if I wrote it down. I suggest to you, sometimes, if we say out loud what really is in our heart, we think to God we will look trite. And most of the times when we write it down, there's a lot of things that will come up that we realize, you know what, that really is not a priority. Now that I hear me say it, wow, that's not a deal breaker. We have expectations that we keep inside, and God says, I want you to find out who you really are. Tell me. Uncertainty brings about fear. Fear, if explored, can reveal our deepest desires and what it is that we really want. When we are able to discover and give God those deep, otherwise unknown to us desires, something happens inside of us. See if I can illustrate. Lord, I need a job. And God might want to say to you, what are you afraid of if you don't get a job? And being really spiritual, we'll say, I'm not afraid of anything, God. Okay, then let me ask you this, God says, what if you don't get a job? What if you don't get a job? What are you afraid of? Oh, I'm afraid for my family. I'm afraid for my reputation. And God can whisper into our heart at that moment, just as I am capable to help you find a job, I am capable to help you if you don't find a job. In our prayers of uncertainty, we need to start to pray, Lord, I think I need you, but if you don't, I'm afraid. Isn't that what Jesus taught us in the garden? Lord, let this cup pass from me. Lord, I think you need to find a different plan, but if you don't, here's what my fear is. Here's what my concerns are. And eventually, you and I, when we say that, when we get to that place of honesty and vulnerability with God, we'll say, God, not my will, but yours be done. This is about placing into God's hand what only God's hands are capable of handling. The result is peace. Not just peace as you and I understand it. Notice how Paul defines it. It surpasses every thought of man. It's in the midst of the crisis, being in perfect peace. It transcends human understanding. It makes no sense at this moment. Why? Because circumstances haven't changed one bit. But I'm at peace. This is peace that precedes change. Peace grounded in the fact that God is in control. Peace stands guard, protects our hearts and our minds, our emotions and our thoughts. When the circumstances and pressures grab our attention, there is peace. We aren't all knotted up inside waiting for the conclusion. When things take us by surprise, it's okay. There is peace. It is an inside thing that sets us apart on the outside. Prayer isn't about changing things. Prayer is about being changed. If you've been at New Hope very long, you know I'm a weird pastor. I don't like the bumper sticker that says prayer changes things. I'm not a fan. Why? Because it's a sound bite that's not complete. Whose prayer? Prayer to who? And is God a Santa Claus that if we just pray to Him, He'll grant our requests? No, prayer is not about God changing stuff. Prayer is about God changing us. Print a bumper sticker that says, "Prayer changes me," and I'll put it on my car. Prayer to Christ changes me. Change to trust the Father with things that only He can control. Change so that we are free from decisions that will only complicate our lives. Change because we have placed into God's hand what only God's hands are capable of handling. Guys, I didn't learn most of what I'm sharing with you today from the Bible, so I believe it's very biblical. The biblical principles I didn't learn because of deep study of the Bible. The biblical principles about prayer that I learned mostly from others. I learned from my mom and dad. Some of my earliest memories are of my mom and dad praying in their bedroom when the door closed, and they were praying out loud for my sister and I. I learned it from friends in Bible college as we traveled in groups of three and four to preach in far-flung portions of the state. And as we traveled to preach, we prayed for each other. I learned it from family members who died of cancer and how they maintained peace in the process of dying. I learned it from a 19-year-old girl who died of cancer, and her one request was to learn more about heaven where she was headed to. I learned on the bathroom floor and around dinner tables of families who became victims of the war on terror. And it is in those places that I learned what deep conversation with God was all about. Early and long on in life, I found a way to pray and to stay in prayer until there was that peace that passed all understanding. And maybe the most turbulent time in my personal life and professional life as a pastor on an airplane, going through the greatest personal turbulence I had ever been in, I had my seatbelt on tight. And somewhere over Louisiana or Texas or Oklahoma, I heard God say, "I'm taking the seatbelt light off. You can get up and move around the room. You will be okay." Because the God who called you to preach as a 15-year-old high school kid is the same God who's with you today. I have not changed. And I can work things that the world intends for evil, and I can use them for good if you will just surrender control to me. We live in a time where resources abound to try to get us through rough spots. But let's not become so excited about the resources that we neglect the original source. Let's pray. When the fasten the seatbelt sign comes on, let our first response be pray. Let's go to that quiet place, not in hopes that the world will change, but let's go to our quiet place and pray for how God wants to change us. It is there in that lonely place that we will gain the perspective and the peace we need to handle the uncertainties of our life. I'd like to jumpstart the process. Let's pray. Our Father, You know us to the very core of our being. You know us better than we know ourselves. That is why I think in the context of familiarity and trust in You, we can say whatever is inside of us, we can vomit it out on the table, and there You will work through it with us You'll take those things that are fears. You'll take those things which are private inhibitions. You will take those things which are major distractions. You will help us confront them and then overcome them. Father, I pray there's some men and women right at this very moment saying, Lord, you know I'm scared to death about. Lord, if this doesn't happen, I don't know what I'll do. And I hope they will give to you their fears. Not that you will necessarily change their circumstances, but that by your marvelous grace, you will change them. Thank you for what you're teaching us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, that's step one. Next week will be step two of what to do when turbulence comes. Have a good afternoon. Don't forget, there are some of these flyers up here if you need a reminder of the service this afternoon.